Many insects feed on plants. These abundant insects are fed upon by a range of carnivorous organisms. Individuals within this broad carnivorous group may be categorized as follows. A predator kills and consumes a number of prey animals during its life. Animals that live at the expense of another single animal, a host, that dies as a result are called parasitoids. It could be further broken down to those that live internally, endoparasitoids, and externally, ectoparasitoids. If they do not normally kill the animals, then it is a parasite, which can also be internal or external. A host attacked by a parasite or a parasitoid is considered parasitized. Some estimate that 25% of insect species are predatory or parasitic in some life stage, although nearly every order has predators. The immature and adults of orders of Odonata, Mantodia, and Neuroptera, and the adults of Macoptera are almost exclusively predatory. Many of the Hymenoptera are parasitoids. This photo shows a female Macopteran feeding on a dead pupa of a small tortoiseshell butterfly. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video I'll show you how predators, parasitoids, and parasites locate and select their prey or hosts, how they overcome host defenses, and relationships between them. The foraging strategies of predators, parasites, and parasitoids involve trade-off between profits or benefits, the quality and quantity of resource obtained, and cost, time spent, exposure to the elements, and risk of being eaten. Sit and wait or ambush predators find a suitable patch and wait for mobile prey to come within striking distance. Many have crypsis, a form of camouflage. They may look like tree bark, lichen, a twig, or a rock. This may be defensive to ward off birds rather than mislead invertebrate prey. Others may look like a flower to attract prey. This Malaysian mantid closely resembles the flowers of this orchid where it rests. Flies are encouraged to land, encouraged by the presence of marks resembling flies on the body of the mantid. Once they land, they are a meal. Many sit and wait predators are ambushers like this dragonfly nymph that rests in submerged vegetation or soil. This saves them energy. One form of ambush also involves hunting tactics. Dragonfly adults often sit perched on vegetation, then dart out and capture prey, much like the flycatchers of the bird world. Trappers are predators that construct traps in which to capture prey. This could be considered a form of ambush. The predator waits near the trap, then pounces on the prey once it is ensnared in the trap. Antlion larvae are the classic example. They use conical pit traps to ambush prey. They must locate, construct, and maintain traps to effectively capture prey. Larvae of the glowworm, a type of gnat, live in moist caves. They spin slimy webs that dangle from the ceiling. The larvae rest behind the web and are bioluminescent, attracting prey into the web. Some forms of this gnat produce a web that is not only sticky, but contains toxic chemicals. Hydrocycid caddisfly larvae also construct nets in which to trap prey. Some smaller assassin bugs of the subfamily Emesinae wait near spider webs and steal the trap prey from the spider. Active searching and suitable patches for prey or hosts require energetic foraging. The search patterns used to locate prey or hosts are either non-directional, random, or directional, non-random. Random searchers roam in the appropriate microhabitat and capture prey upon contact. Microhabitats may include leaf edges, veins, stems, flowers, etc. After an initial contact or meal, further searching involves more frequent turns, resulting in the predator remaining in the same general location. Random searchers are the most common type of insect predator. Examples include most coleoptera predators, coccinellids, syrphid larvae, and lacewings. Hunting or directional foraging differs from random searching by using sight or other stimuli to orient to prey from a distance. Many hunters initially identify prey items via vision. A sphecid wasp that preys upon bees will attack any flying object that is approximately the same size as a bee, but will only sting an actual bee, suggesting that tactile stimuli are used at close range. Robber flies and dragonflies have enormous eyes for detecting prey items in flight. Initial host location may also occur via chemical cues. Many predators use chemical signals produced by the prey for intraspecific communication. Parasitic tachinophiles and braconid wasps locate their respective stink bug or coccoid hosts by following their host's long-distance sex-attractant pheromones. Parasitoid hymenopterans follow the aggregation pheromones of their bark and timber beetle hosts. Other predators locate hosts by detecting chemicals emitted from stressed or insect-damaged plants. Parasitoids of scolided timber beetles cue into the terpenes that are released from the infested pine trees. Just as phytophages find their host plants by volatile chemicals, predators of these phytophages are also attracted by these chemicals. Some parasitoids can even detect frass odors from their insect larval hosts. Host location is also accomplished by detecting sound. Blood-sucking flies of hylid tree frogs cue into the frog's calls. Tachinid parasitoids of some crickets find their hosts by listening to the cricket's calls. Sarcophagid parasitoids of cicadas do likewise. Serpagonid biting midges find swarms of prey midges by detecting the sounds produced by wing beat frequencies. Foresy is a unique method of host location that involves hitchhiking. A predator or parasitoid jumps onto another insect that carries it to a new location. This is seen with a lot of mites. The new location may place the predatory insect in close proximity to a new host or prey. One species of ectoparasitic fly of some birds transport avian lice from one bird nest to another. Many egg parasitoids attach themselves to adult females of the host species, thereby gaining instant access to her eggs. Other phoretic species attach to and are carried back to the nest of the transport species. Some calcid hymenopterans have larvae that actively seek out worker ants, to which they attach and eventually burrow into ant grubs and pupate within the nest. Female botflies capture mosquitoes, hold them in such a way to prevent injury, then place about 30 eggs on the undersurface, which will not interfere with flight. This mosquito then carries the botfly eggs to the vertebrate hosts. The elevation of temperature associated with the vertebrate hosts induces the eggs to rapidly hatch and fall onto the host. A step-by-step sequence of stimuli is usually necessary for prey location and acceptance and may involve the shape of the prey, chemical coatings of the prey, and volatile chemicals produced by a host plant of the prey. Often size and/or age of the potential prey or host are assessed. Chemical and tactile stimuli are involved in species identification and may include the predator biting or piercing the potential prey. Predators must be able to restrain their prey while killing it. This is often accomplished using raptorial legs, as in mantids, modified hind legs, as seen in some scorpionflies, or the labial mask of odonate nymphs. Odonate nymphs capture passing prey by striking out with a highly modified labium, which projects outwards by release of hydrostatic pressure rather than muscles. Mouthparts of predators are of two general types. Modification of various elements, labrum, labial palps, labium, maxilla, hypopharynx of the head and mouthparts form piercing sucking mouthparts with stylets that are either slender and needle-like or knife-like. The mandibles are strengthened and elongate, as in this antlion mandible where the maxilla fits against the groove to form a sucking tube. Many predators with piercing sucking mouthparts also inject enzymes into the prey, then suck up the pre-digested liquid, extraoral digestion. Only material that is digestible is taken into the body. This is obviously more efficient than eating the organism whole. Initially, chemoreceptors in the antennae signal information as to the appropriateness of the potential host. Many parasitoid hymenoptera support relatively long antennae. Species identification is confirmed by receptors located in the ovipositor of the female parasitoid. Parasitoids of wood-boring insects must find their host strictly using chemoreceptors on the ovipositor. Size and/or age of the potential host are also assessed. Many parasitoids reject old larvae that are close to pupation. while others seek out the biggest, oldest larvae. Endoparasitoid dipterans may oviposit into the cuticle or directly onto the host. Heteromorphic larvae are common within the parasitoid taxa, such as these botfly larvae. These larvae are active as first instars, seek out and find hosts, then metamorphose into relatively inactive, non-motile larvae. These larvae will metamorphose again at pupation. The usual host reaction to a parasitoid egg or larva is encapsulation by aggregating hematocytes. Phagocytosis usually follows. Parasitoids in their normal host have evolved ways to avoid encapsulation. Through avoidance, the parasitoid resides in a particular organ like the brain, a ganglion, a salivary gland, or the gut, and thus escape the immune reaction of the host hemolymph. Through evasion, the parasitoid may be a molecular mimic to the host proteins and not recognized by the host as being non-self, or the parasitoid insulates itself in a membrane or capsule, or development is so rapid that the host cannot respond in time to encapsulate. Through suppression, a host's cellular immune responses may be suppressed by viruses associated with the parasitoid. Through subversion, the parasitoid is resistant to encapsulation and/or the capsule is subverted for use as a sheath. Most parasitoids are host discriminant and will not oviposit into or onto a host that is already harboring a parasitoid. Some parasitoids practice superparasitism, laying their eggs in parasitized hosts. All the eggs received by the host are from the same species of the parasitoid. In multiparasitism, the host receives eggs from more than one species of parasitoid. Hyperparasitism involves a parasitoid parasitizing the larva of another parasitoid. Some species are obligate, developing only within primary parasitoids, and others are facultative hyperparasitoids, may also develop as primary parasitoids. This figure reflects multiparasitism or hyperparasitism. Most parasitoids are restricted to a single species of host. This type of specificity is analogous to that seen in the monophagous phytophages, insects feeding on one plant species. Polyembryony is found only among parasitoids. A single egg may divide to form new eggs, which all develop into larvae. As many as 1,500 embryos in a single caterpillar have been counted after oviposition by female Insertidae, Hymenoptera. Some Insertids lay two types of eggs. The defender morphs hatch first and seek out and destroy any larvae already present in the host. These larvae fail to pupate and die. The second type of egg hatches later, and the larvae are reproductive morphs, completing development. In conclusion, predators, parasites, and parasitoids use a variety of techniques to find, accept, and manipulate hosts. I hope this was helpful.